Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 8764 in the name of Douglas Ross on transparency of Scotland's governing party. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Douglas Ross to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name, and I hope with the early start we have a bit more flexibility in some of the timings this afternoon, because I'm very keen that this is a proper debate, that we interact with each other, and I'm looking forward to interventions from the government benches, who I'm sure have a lot to say on this topic, because transparency at the heart of government, and indeed at the heart of the governing party, is crucial. It's important to each and every one of us. But the fact is, we shouldn't need this debate to get that transparency from the First Minister or from the Scottish Government. Because I made a very open offer just a couple of weeks ago to the First Minister to come here and give a statement to this Parliament on the issues engulfing his party, the party of government here in Scotland. It was a genuine offer at First Minister's Questions Time for the First Minister to put on record his point of view, his answers, and indeed his responses to crucial questions that remain unanswered weeks into this sorry saga. I will give way.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. He says he is genuine. Could he expand on that by telling us the membership of the Conservative Party in Scotland? Is it 6,500 as the number who voted in the last leadership election?
Douglas Ross.
In the most predictable intervention of the afternoon, yeah, which will probably be repeated by several others, and I thought it might have actually come from the Minister, but maybe he's got that later on in his script. The point is, the Scottish Conservatives announce their membership numbers during a leadership election.
Exactly.
That's always been the way we have approached this issue. The point from the SNP benches seems to be, and the noise from the front bench seems to be, the Scottish Conservatives and other parties here in Scotland should change our approach because the Nationalists lied to the press, lied to the public across Scotland about their membership numbers. So I'll take no lectures from the SNP who want to see a change in approach from the other parties to cover up for the lies that those in the SNP made about those membership numbers. And that is a serious allegation.
Mr Ross, can I please ask you to resume your seat just a wee sec? I think it might be instructive if I, at this stage in the debate, remind members that there are certain expectations about language in the Chamber. And, of course, we know that the Chair will not tolerate an accusation, for example, that a fellow member has been deliberately untruthful. I would also perhaps remind members of a statement made by previous presiding officer, the late Sir Alex Ferguson, who reminded members at the time that the words lies, lying or liar should not be used in the chamber in relation to other members. And indeed, he went on to add, and preferably not at all. Douglas Ross.
I think we did clarify this all through the presiding officer's office this morning, and I am not saying any individual member in here lied. I am just saying there was clearly actions from the SNP on their misleading claims about their own membership numbers that led to the resignation of the head of media of the SNP MSPs, that led to the resignation of the former chief executive of the SNP. Just days before he was arrested by the police, he resigned from a role he had held for years because of the conduct of the SNP on their membership number. So that's why I'm saying I will take no lectures from the SNP on this issue. But the fact is, there are and remain serious questions to be answered. Now, the First Minister seems quite happy to answer these questions outside the chamber. He always stops to speak to the press to give his views on a whole host of issues. And as an opposition leader, I want to see that continue, because he's only, I think, been beaten by Colin Beattie in his attempts to provide no more press stories by then answering the press and providing us with plenty of nuggets and press stories going forward. So if the First Minister is happy to give those answers to the press just a few metres from this chamber, why is he not happy to come in here to answer those questions? Not just is he unwilling to answer the questions in this chamber. He's unwilling to even attend today to respond to these points. And there are so many questions, Deputy Presiding Officer. For example, how was the supposedly ring-fenced IndiaRef2 funds raised through RefScot and YesScot spent? How was that money spent? Why did the party's former chief executive, Peter Murrell, give the SNP a six-figure loan? And when will that loan be repaid? Was this loan a consideration in the decision not to suspend Peter Murrell, not to suspend Colin Beattie and potentially any other MSP currently serving in this parliament who may find themselves arrested by the police? Why was the unused motorhome kept at the home of the former First Minister, Minister's mother-in-law's home? And why were members of the SNP's Finance and Audit Committee refused information on the party accounts? So we have several senior members in government and in the SNP in the chamber today. There's a flavour of some of the questions we would like to put to the First Minister. In his absence, can any single SNP MSP answer those questions? Silence. Silence. We've got the Deputy First Minister of the Government, the Deputy Leader of the party here in Scotland, and no answers to very basic questions that are being asked by our constituents and members of the public across the country. Now, I think it's really important that we have transparency at the heart of government, and we have a governing party that is willing to answer these questions. But sadly, we don't. And in the time left available to me, Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to look at the amendment that is just about to be moved by the Parliamentary Business Manager for the Scottish Government. This is an amendment which incredibly deletes massive amounts of the motion I put forward and deletes some key lines. George Adam wants SNP MSPs tonight to vote for an amendment that deletes that they agree the scandal engulfing the party of government here in Scotland should be properly scrutinised and debated. Why would you not want that properly scrutinised and debated? His amendment deletes the line calling for a more transparent budget process. Why would you not want a more transparent budget process? His amendment deletes the line that says we should give arm-length organisations control over information publication. Why would you not want to give them more control over the publication of key information? And it also deletes the line that calls for an improvement in the scrutiny of the breach of ministerial code. Why would any MSP representing the governing parties here in Scotland tonight vote for that amendment which takes out these key lines on transparency, on openness? Deputy Presiding Officer, today marks 16 years since the SNP were elected into government. And during that time, we have seen secrecy, spin and cover-ups from the heart of government. Today is an opportunity for SNP members to say enough is enough. It has been happening for too long. They can do that by voting for the Scottish Conservative motion tonight, supporting the Labour amendment, which adds to the scrutiny we are seeking, and voting down the shameful amendment from the Scottish Government, which wants to delete so much of the transparency this Parliament and the people of Scotland deserve.
Thank you, Mr Ross. I now call on George Adam, Minister, to speak to and to move Amendment 8764.
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Well, Minister, I have to read out my bit first. To move Amendment 8764.2. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just so keen to get involved in this debate, Presiding Officer. That was definitely a thing from Douglas Ross there. Not sure what it was, not sure what the relevance much of it had to what we're talking about here today. But let me tell him right from the start. The important thing for me is the fact that transparency and scrutiny of this government is important. That's why it's in the amendment and that's why it's actually there. So, Presiding Officer, can I take this opportunity to move the amendment in my name? And, Presiding Officer, can I just say one thing to start with? On the 1st of April, many people might find that the irony in this. Douglas Ross was in the great town of Paisley, where he was there for one of his many jobs, the one of being a football referee. It was an important game between St Mirren and Livingston. Mr Ross had a terrible game as he missed a Stonewall penalty in the first 4 minutes, but luckily that was corrected by VAR. But this is a relevant and interesting point, Presiding Officer. There was a crowd. There was a crowd of 5,894 people attending. Many contemplated that may or may not be the membership of the Scottish Tory Party, but that's the reason. We will never know, Presiding Officer, because the Conservatives won't publish, won't be transparent, and they won't practice what they're trying to preach here. The absolute hypocrisy. No, we've heard enough from you, Mr. Ross. The absolute hypocrisy. The absolute hypocrisy from the Conservatives is almost laughable. Presiding Officer, you have to admire someone who has that level of brass neck, who need to complain about a lack of party transparency when you lead the Scottish Conservative Party. Mr. Ross's political party that illegally prorogued the UK Parliament and avoid debate and scrutiny, the party of a Prime Minister that would only agree to speak to the Scottish press if he could handpick the media and he could actually handpick the questions. The party that packs the House of Lords with donors like Scotland Office Minister Lord Offord, who, after being appointed for life in the House of Lords and given a place in the government payroll, had given the Tories £150,000. And the Tories come to us here in the Scottish Parliament and they talk about our integrity. This party, the Conservatives, have received hundreds of thousands from unincorporated associations that do not reveal their origin of funding, and they have questioned the integrity of others. You just cannot take the Tories seriously on this issue. A party that refused to say how many members it has while criticising those that do. There is a word for this, Presiding Officer, and a word for that person, and it is a hypocrite. And I'm not going to stand here and claim that there are not issues in the SNP which need to be addressed. But I can stand here and say that these issues are being addressed. Mr. Ross is having a lot of fun and games over here in the corner, just shouting from the sidelines. It must be from his time as a referee. But within days of Hamza Yousaf's election...
Minister, please resume. We can't have two members standing at the same time. I think, Mr. Ross, the Minister probably indicated by his not taking your intervention request that he probably isn't planning to take your intervention. Minister, please resume.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. But what I have said is the fact that we are dealing with this. The First Minister, within days of his election as leader, announced an urgent review of internal party governance. And as our amendment makes clear, this government that places a great importance in openness and transparency. We are fully committed to meeting the standards of public rightly expects of us being an open government. Let me give you just a few examples of that. Ministerial engagements and travel are published monthly. We also aim to proactively publish minutes of government meetings on our website so that people can see who their government is meeting with and what we are discussing and understand how discussions are made. We are focused on making the necessary improvements in handling freedom of information requests, as set out in our published improvement plan agreed with the Information Commissioner. Our performance on responding to requests on the time is comparable with the wider public sector in Scotland, at around 86%. But it is important to note that we are responding to significantly more requests for information, rising by over 50% in the past 3 years. We also recently enhanced transparency on the Scottish Government finances to Parliament and public, including through providing more detailed outturn reporting and providing more detailed material to the Finance and Public Administration Committee, which I know all members of that committee have welcomed. Mr. Arthur will provide more detail on the steps we have taken to improve engagement on budget in his closing statement here today. Presiding Officer, let me come back to the issue of party membership. Much has been said, but not enough. We are not hearing what their members are. Because of the five parties represented in this chamber, only two have published up-to-date figures of their party members. That's the SNP and the Scottish Greens. And I'm quite happy if he wants to say the membership now.
Douglas Ross.
grateful we've finally had an intervention. But will the minister accept that his party lied about their figures that led to the resignation, in this parliament of the head of media and then the party's chief executive? And will he apologise to the press and the public for that?
Minister.
My goodness, presiding officer, I gave him the opportunity to build himself up into a frenzy, and that was a bit of a damp squid there from him. This coming from the party of Boris Johnson and all the nonsense that has gone on in Westminster. You know, Douglas Ross has refused to actually publish his members, numbers of his members. He says he has nothing to hide, yet he continues to hide it. His defence in an interview with ITV Border is that the party only publishes its membership figures during a leadership election. Presiding officer, given Douglas Ross's performance today and in recent weeks, I don't think we'll be waiting too long for these figures to be published.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Jackie Bailey to speak too and to move Amendment 8764.1.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The culture of secrecy, spin and cover-up at the heart of the SNP has been laid bare for all to see with the recent revelations about their finances. Now, I have to say I find it extraordinary that the SNP's sole defence is to demand membership numbers from the opposition when they are being investigated by Police Scotland. This is serious and it's not about their membership numbers. Now, we cannot comment on the substance of the investigation, as this is a live police inquiry. But suffice to say, if you had told me 10 weeks ago that I would witness the resignation of the First Minister, the arrest under caution of her husband, Peter Murrell, former Chief Executive of the SNP, the arrest of Colin Beattie, MSP, former SNP Treasurer, and a blue forensic tent on the front lawn of Nicola Sturgeon's home, I would have said you were delusional. But that is indeed what has happened. This is a shameful episode in Scottish politics. People who believed in the SNP have been badly let down, but so too have the people of Scotland. The governing party is mired in scandal, which is a complete distraction from focusing on the people's priorities. And what we are witnessing now is the arrogance of a party who have been in power for far too long, thinking they are untouchable and treating this parliament and the public with contempt. Now, I know many people will say that the party and government are two separate things, but that is simply not true in this case. The culture that pervades the SNP as a party pervades the SNP-led Scottish government too. They are inextricably linked. No wonder when you consider that the top two positions were occupied by a husband and wife team. But let me illustrate that and take you back to the inquiry into the Scottish Government handling of harassment complaints, otherwise known as the Salmond Inquiry. And let me start by reminding the Chamber of Nicola Sturgeon's words. The inquiries will be able to request whatever material they want, and I undertake today that we will provide whatever material they request. My commitment is that the Government and I will fully cooperate. 17th of January 2019. What hollow words, Presiding Officer. The SNP, in the guise of Nicola Sturgeon, John Swinney and her Chief of Staff, Liz Lloyd, blocked every attempt by the committee to get information. It dragged on for months, if not a full year, as they defied the will of the committee and of Parliament at every turn. Letters from the Parliament's lawyers were effectively ignored, and it took the threat of a successful vote of no confidence in John Swinney to get the material released. Evading scrutiny and accountability underpinned much of the SNP's approach to the Salmond Inquiry. The use of SNP emails and WhatsApp groups by cabinet ministers, the former FM and special advisers, was widespread to avoid formally recording ministerial discussion and decisions. The dissembling, the dishonesty, the duplicitous behaviour on the part of government was routine. And then there were the memory lapses, the inability to recall or remember from people who, it has to be said up to that point, had the sharpest of memories for details. And then there was the incompetence and a new low. The leaking of material by the then Deputy First Minister and his special advisers to journalists writing a book about the inquiry after the inquiry that had not even been shared with the inquiry in the first place. But of course, Whilst this breached the Ministerial Code of Conduct and the Special Advisor's Code of Conduct, the then First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, chose to do nothing about it. Such contempt for Parliament. Presiding Officer, it is time for an overhaul of the Parliament's ability to hold this government to account. Scottish Labour have a plan for doing just that. Let's start by seeing fewer Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers. Let's see binding sanctions for breaches of the Ministerial Code. Let's see more power for committees to compel witnesses and evidence, and less tribalism from members that try to deny the evidence presented to committee before their very eyes. And yes, let's have a right of recall for MSPs that break the law, whoever they are. Presiding Officer, the SNP are tarnishing the reputation of this Parliament and of government. They are mired in scandal, they are divided and fighting like ferrets in a sack. They are contemptuous of the Scottish people and have completely lost focus on the people's priorities. It's time they were held to account, it's time for a Scottish election, and it's most certainly time for change. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. And I now call on Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's been a painful few weeks for the SNP. A party that has seemed impregnable for the last 16 years, now shambling, anarchic, quarrelling. I almost feel sorry for them. But we must all feel sorry for Mike Russell, the modest, self-effacing president of the Scottish National Party. At the last election, for 4 whole weeks, he was forced to live in a smelly old horse box. If only he had known, poor President Mike could have been chauffeured in that executive motorhome. I can almost see it. In fact, I can't get the image out of my head. President Mike thrust atop the luxury motorhome, draped over his chaise longue, dressed in his satin robe, addressing his adoring crowds at Dunoon Pier. What a glorious sight that would have been. But like everyone else, he was kept in the dark. So we do need transparency. The current troubles within the SNP have further undermined faith in the governing party on public finances and their ability to look after the public finances. This is on top of the waste of millions of pounds of hard-earned public money. £50 million to save 1,500 jobs at Bifab, wasted. £586 million to create 2,000 jobs at Lochaber, which are nowhere to be seen. £300 million to build 2 new ferries, which are over budget and over time. Boosting their public image by wasting public money. All this waste when people are struggling to make ends meet, when people are desperate for a decent home, when the NHS is on its knees, when schools are struggling, when the climate is in crisis. No wonder people have had enough when this SNP government spaff their money up against the wall, when the country and the people count every single penny. But I have to get this off my chest. The Conservatives have got a nerve to talk about standards. No party has done more to damage faith in politics than the Conservatives. This is the party that gave us Boris Johnson and Liz Truss. Boris Johnson, with the parties in COVID, the loans, the decor in number 10 flat, the PPE contracts for friends, the defence of friends who breached the rules. Liz Truss and a reckless budget and cavalier dismissal of the so-called blob cost billions of pounds, ramping up the cost of mortgages, rents and the cost of living. And what about Douglas Ross? Some call him Dithering Douglas. He couldn't even make up his mind about the blundering Boris Johnson and the gormless Liz Truss, condemning them one minute, hailing them the next. We do need change in politics, but it won't come with the Conservatives and it won't come with the SNP. We do need change. Katie Clark's bill for extending the freedom of information powers to follow the money so that we have greater understanding of how our money is spent. The pre-release of statistics so the government can't spend hours and days manipulating the facts before they publish the statistics. Making sure that we have a recall system like we have in Westminster that evades the Scottish Parliament and our ability to throw out recalcitrant MSPs. We need to have all of those powers in this Parliament to have a change. Now, we can agree to some of the elements in the motion today about the ministerial code and about transparency, but I have to say the rest of the motion is utter tosh. The Scottish Parliament is not the SNP conference, nor is the SNP National Executive Committee. Our job in this Parliament is to run the country. Our job is not to run the SNP.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We will now move to the open debate. Speeches of 4 minutes. And I call on Liz Smith to be followed by John Mason. Liz Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It was only last Thursday when this Parliament debated the issue of transparency. And we agreed in principle, all of us, including SNP members in the debate, that this Parliament has a primary duty to the public to be as open and as transparent as possible when it comes to accounting for public money. So too do government ministers. And taxpayers surely have a right to know exactly what their money is being spent on, just as importantly, why elected members in this place make certain choices. And as politicians, we need to be held fully accountable for every single decision we make, most especially when it comes to spending other people's money. Now, I completely understand that there is an ongoing police inquiry about current events inside the SNP, and it is not appropriate to comment upon these aspects of recent events. But, as Douglas Ross rightly said, that should not overshadow the very important issue about the lack of transparency both inside the government and inside Scotland's ruling party, because they are interlinked. This Parliament has a clear interest in establishing probity, and so we will not shy away from asking very important questions of the First Minister. Deputy Presiding Officer, Auditor Generals around the world believe that there are 5 acknowledged principles of good governance: accountability, leadership, integrity, stewardship, and transparency. Now, personally, I don't see how anyone could argue otherwise or seek to undermine these principles. Yet, with regard to that latter point, that is exactly what we have currently within the SNP, and it is a matter of public interest. Just yesterday, The Times reported on the Finance Committee's current inquiry into the efficacy of Scottish Government decision-making, and it does not make good reading for the Scottish Government, not just because too much decision-making has been seen by senior civil servants and former senior ministers to be rushed, unclear and unstructured, but also that some financial rules have on occasion been found to be optional. That must be a concern for us all. Yet the Scottish Government, despite the fact that the committee's inquiry is not yet concluded, seems to be rubbishing that report. And that is just not acceptable. Because as a member of that committee, I am very clear indeed that all is not well when it comes to government openness, transparency and accountability. Yes, it's true that Audit Scotland and the Scottish Fiscal Commission have welcomed some of the efforts to improve the Scottish budget transparency, but they have also warned very strongly that it simply isn't good enough. And we've heard so much about the profligate waste of failed Scottish Government projects, somewhere in the region of £350 million. And the committee has been told that we have to start thinking about serious reforms so that we get much better transparency. Deputy Presiding Officer, the named person legislation, the hate crime bill, the National Care Service bill, gender recognition reform, the deposit return scheme and the HPMAs, which we'll debate later, these are all examples of Scottish Government failures when it comes to good governance. And on top of all this, and worst of all, we have the murky and disreputable goings-on inside the party of government. Openness and transparency are not only good practice to measure the best value for taxpayers' money, but it is also because that openness and that transparency are essential if there is to be renewed trust between government and the public. Now, that current loss of that trust is very serious, and it is particularly serious for this country. So I support the motion in the name of Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now call John Mason to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Mr Mason.
Thank you very much. There's certainly a lot in this motion and in the amendments today, so I will not try to cover everything in 4 minutes. In the first place, concerning the SNP accounts, I understand that a police investigation is underway and we need to let that take its course. No one has been charged as yet, and we have a system which says someone is innocent until proven guilty. So it seems to me to be far too soon to be having statements or debates in Parliament. When we look at the last published accounts of the SNP, which were to the year to 31st December 2021, they show net assets of £610,000. They also report that the referendum appeal raised £740,000, of which £253,000 had already been used. So the balance on the referendum fund of £487,000 is covered by the assets on the balance sheet. On current membership of UK political parties, the House of Commons Library makes it clear that parties do not need to publish numbers. However, they show that the Conservatives at last September had 172,000 members. If we are generous and give the Scottish Tories 9% of that, it would mean that they had some 16,000 members, although only 6,500 voted in 2020. So either way, they are way behind the SNP. Labour were reported to have 432,000 members at December 21, and 9% would give them about 39,000. But the record reported it was only 16,000. I'm afraid I've only got 4 minutes. So the SNP is clearly well ahead of both these parties with 74,000 members. In percentage terms of the relevant electorate, the SNP would be about 1.7%, Labour 0.9% and the Conservatives 0.4%. So it is pretty clear which party has the most members, is the most popular with the public and wins the most elections. Moving on to transparency around budgets, this is a serious point. I am not quite clear what practical differences the Conservatives want made. For example, I think both the SNP and the Greens have been very open and clear that if we want better public services, we need to consider raising taxes. By contrast, the Conservatives have called for lower taxes, but simultaneously asked for extra spending on a range of areas. This is neither honest nor transparent. In fact, it is impossible. The Tories might set an example in transparency by saying where they would cut public services to match tax cuts. Now, when it comes to transparency within political parties, we could do no worse than look at the House of Lords. As members know, the SNP does not take seats there because the Lords are unelected, and that is an affront to democracy. Britain cannot be considered a true democracy as long as one half of its parliament is appointed and not elected. And how do these people get appointed? Well, some may be there on merit, but for others it seems they just pay money to the Conservative Party. I understand that around £3 million is the going rate. We are told that 15 of the last 16 Conservative Party treasurers have been offered a seat in the House of Lords, having each donated more than £3 million to the party. And it's not only party treasurers. It is reported that since 2010, 22 of the Tories' main financial backers have been given peerages, having donated at least £54 million to the party. Other nominations have been blocked by the Lords Appointments Commission, and they tried to block Peter Crudas in 2020. But Boris Johnson overruled them and he got his peerage. Open Democracy and Brunel University said the chances of so many Tory donors ending up in the Lords is equivalent to entering the National Lottery 12 times in a row and winning the jackpot every time. To be clear, it is illegal to sell titles for money, but this has only been forced once in 1933. And just to mention Labour in passing, they seek the right of recall for MSPs, but we should not forget that Labour's Mike Watson had to resign after he got a 16-month sentence for trying to set fire to a hotel, but he still sits as a Labour member in the House of Lords. Maybe Labour should clean up its own act first.
Mr Mason, you need to conclude.
So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, politics can be a dirty business. No party is completely squeaky clean, but I'd argue that if we are looking for a party heavily engaged in sleaze, underhand deals, lacking transparency and selling seats in the House of Lords, it is the Conservative Party. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Russell Finlay. Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to follow John Mason, although I'm not sure the concept of squeaky clean parties will resonate with our constituents outside of here. This has obviously already been a robustious debate, which I think was to be expected. However, to the heart of it are very important questions that this Parliament needs to ask itself, the people of Scotland need to ask themselves, and also to understand the difference between political parties, between the Scottish Government and between the Parliament, and where the powers should lie for this Parliament to hold to account the Government of Scotland. And it is right that surely any party, any member, indeed any citizen of Scotland, should be interested in upholding those very basic democratic principles that we have here, and to look to strengthen this Parliament, irrespective of the party membership that makes up this chamber, that this Parliament can hold to account properly the Scottish Government, because that is the role that constituents send us here to do when not in the majority party that then forms the government. And I think it is fair to say that there has been a great deal and increasing lack of transparency over 16 years as to how the Scottish Government operates. We have heard already discussions over the budget, and indeed within the motions there are calls to clear and make that more transparent. However, there are other matters that are addressed both in the motion and indeed the Labour amendment that I would like to take the short time that I have to draw attention to. And the first is in respect to the size of the government. The government can only be drawn here in Scotland, bar for one position, from members of this chamber. And we have seen an increase in the size of the government, both in cabinet secretaries but also in ministers who support, that clearly causes challenges when it comes to supplying membership for committees. And given that we are a unicameral parliament here, the responsibility on committees to hold the government to account is enormous. And the pool that can be drawn to make up those committees is, of course, reduced where the number of ministers are increased. And
Ross Greer.
I'm grateful to the member for the intervention. There's much in the Labour amendment that I sympathise with, but this is the line that I have a problem with. I'd be interested if Mr Whitfield would acknowledge that this Parliament and the Scottish Government are far more powerful than they were in 1999, but the number of members in the Parliament remains unchanged. Is the issue not the number of members of this Parliament rather than the number of members in the Government?
Martin Whitfield.
I absolutely welcome the recognition of the increased powers that devolution has given to the Government and indeed the Parliament here in Scotland. And I would agree there's a challenge in that balance. And I wonder whether, when we look at the De Hoyt calculation, whether or not a more balanced approach could be achieved if we reduce or deduct from the De Hoyt calculation those members of the predominant party that are in government, to give a balance across as to speeches and to debates. I am conscious that there are going to be many very positive contributions, but I do want to mention my colleague Katie Clark's private members bill on the FOI legislation and look forward to seeing that come forward. And my final comment, which I would ask the Cabinet Secretary or Minister to deal with at the end, is in respect of breaches of ministerial code. Ministerial code is not overseen by the Parliament or any committees within here, and we have a situation where, in essence, the judge is judging themselves. We have seen the problems of that down south in Westminster, and I would invite ideas as to how that's going to improve under the current Scottish Government. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. I now call Russell Finlay to be followed by Stuart Millen. Mr Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP is engulfed in scandal. Police Scotland are following the money. Arrests have been made. Resignations have been rapid. Front pages have been lurid. The wheels of justice are turning. But this is actually quite a familiar story. For decades, the Scottish Labour Party arrogantly viewed Scotland as its fiefdom, its iron grip unbreakable, no matter how badly they behaved or how poorly they performed. And we know what happened. People grew sick of being taken for granted. Mm-hmm. They finally rejected the sleaze and corruption, and Labour went the way of the dinosaurs. Self-righteous SNP politicians like Nicola Sturgeon were the noisiest critics. Unfortunately not. I've only got 4 minutes, I'm sorry. Their party would be different. Scottish politics would be cleansed, was their pious pitch. Honesty, integrity and transparency were the buzzwords. Dear, dear me, look at where we are now. These past 16 years of SNP rule have been a disaster for our country. This is a single-issue party which is perpetually distracted, distracted by their incoherent obsession of breaking up the United Kingdom. A party with all the power in the hands of Nicola Sturgeon and her husband, a party which does not tolerate reasonable questions from its own people, a party which thinks nothing of destroying those who do not toe the line. In recent weeks, I've seen SNP members in a state of shock, party unity shattered. They've been put in the spot and forced to pick a team. One newspaper identified the following seven factions: the Yusuf loyalists, the Forbes followers, the Sturgeon establishment, the Westminster wing, the Rebel Alliance, who I believe sit up the back, the Watchers, and indeed the Sheep. Now, many in the SNP are trying to tell us that this is private party business, that this has got nothing to do with Parliament or government. Well, they are wrong, because this toxic culture of the SNP has been allowed to infect St Andrew's House and Holyrood. We have government which operates by three main principles: secrecy, spin and self-preservation. Deprive the public of information while preaching about transparency, mislead the public while preaching about integrity, and when cornered, when evidence of wrongdoing and corruption are laid bare, respond with aggressive deflection and deception. Now, let's talk about accountability. This government acts as if it answers to no one. Even the Auditor General for Scotland is impeded in his work, unable to access critical yet basic financial data. Everyone else is blamed. Colossal and costly failures usually result in promotion, not the sack. Look no further than Humza Yousaf. The SNP has forgotten that principles matter. Values of honesty and integrity are gone from this government. The only values they are interested in are the ministerial salaries of Humza Yousaf's continuity cronies. What is now clear is that SNP politicians have absolutely no right to wag their fingers at anybody else. Just like the pigs in George Orwell's Animal Farm, the SNP now looks no different to Labour. These scandals have exposed an out-of-touch governing class of careerists and chancellors. They could travel Scotland in their mysterious motorhome, but they will never find the moral high ground. They're as transparent as the painted-on windows of the ferry launched by Nicola Sturgeon. They've lost their way, and if political justice is done, they will also lose the power which they take for granted. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Finlay. I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Ross Greer. Ms McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I just want to apologise to yourself for just coming in slightly late at the very beginning of the session. Presiding Officer, at the outset, I will concede one point to the Tories with regards to the motion that we are debating today. It is abundantly clear that there are a range of issues facing my party at present. A party that has had stability for 19 years, a party that's been the party of choice for the electorate in this Parliament since 2007, and a party that's been the choice of the electorate at Westminster for Scots since 2015. The issues are great, certainly not of my choosing, but I'm convinced that we will get through them. And with a huge amount of work, the electorate, I do believe the electorate will continue to place their trust in us to deliver for the people of Scotland. There are many aspects of the motion that do surprise me, though, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that the Tories seem to now accept that Westminster doesn't speak for Scotland, as their motion speaks of, and I quote, the governing party of Scotland. The Tories continually proclaim that Scotland has got two governments. Does this mean that the Tories are now about to give up on the long discredited union and the absolute shambles of a government down the road in Westminster? Ultimately, Presiding Officer, nobody in Scotland will be fooled by this debate. It's the Tories who are playing cheap party political games, chasing headlines with absolute zero credibility. Describing last week's debate on the abhorrent and inhumane illegal migration bill, Brian Whittle said, and I quote, that we could have had a constructive debate this afternoon, but we have instead had an exercise in performative anger. Brian Whittle then went on to describe that debate as, and I quote, an exercise in posturing in the absence of policy and a point-scoring exercise and nothing more. I had no idea, genuinely no idea, that Brian Whittle is the Scottish Parliament's very own Nostradamus, but his predictions are so very apt for today's debate. Now, the Tories talk about transparency as if they actually care about it. But this from the party, this from the party that's been up to their eyeballs in scandals including cash for honours, cash for contracts, texts for tax breaks and even cash for curtains. In the eyes of the public, this is a UK government that has normalised sleaze. Now let's take one example of the abuse of power, the cash for honours scandal. 15 of the Tory party's main treasurers who happened to hand over £3 million to the party were coincidentally given life peerages to the House of Lords. 22 of the Tory party's top financial backers have all coincidentally been given peerages since 2010. In total, this group has stuffed the Tory party coffers with £54 million. Yes, £54 million. Now, we even have a situation. You even have a situation where the former Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, tried to give his dad a peerage. Come on! What's all that about? Come on, I mean, Mr Kerr, I mean, you're laughing, but mind, even Boris Johnson tried to give his dad a peerage. Now, the Tories' claim about transparency indicates the parallel universe in which the Tories live. And only last week it was the Tories who wanted to shut out the press from asking their Prime Minister questions at the Scottish conference. Now, Presiding Officer, the economic lessons that we were supposed to take from Liz Truss and Kwasi Kwarteng's time in charge were much lauded by Mr Ross before he quickly realised he'd actually backed the wrong horse. Now, this is on top of the lying and scheming of the Brexit campaign led by Boris Johnson, which is estimated to have made the UK economy 5.5% poorer now than it would have been if we'd stayed in the EU, and with UK import and exports expected to be 15% lower also. And it's no wonder that IMF predicts that the UK is set to be the worst performing economy in the G20. So, Presiding Officer, the Tories want transparency. Maybe they can respond to the following. Do they agree with £8.7 billion wasted on unused or unusable PPE, storing it and prematurely cancelling PPE contracts? Do they agree with the Commons Public Accounts Committee report which found, and I quote, no clear evidence that the £29.5 billion spent in test and trace had any impact on reducing COVID infections? And do they agree that a firm owned by ex-Conservative councillor and Tory donor was awarded contracts worth £275 million for the supply of masks and gowns?
I could go on, but I'm conscious of time,
so the public know it, and they will not be fooled by today's debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McMillan. I now call Ross Greer to be followed by Keith Brown. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And believe it or not, buried under the hypocrisy and the double standards in this motion, there are a few points which are actually issues for which the Scottish Government has responsibility. And believe it or not, on one of the points I actually agree. The First Minister's salary is an entirely reasonable level at which to set a threshold for proactive publication of the list of posts within the public sector in receipt of high levels of pay. But I would actually go further than what the Conservatives propose. Significant services are delivered by the private sector on the public sector's behalf, and high levels of pay inequality are certainly far more prevalent in the private sector. So if the aim is to reduce pay inequality and ensure best value for money with the public purse, I'd not only support regular publication of the public sector posts with salaries or at or above that of the First Minister, as the Conservative motion proposes, I'd want to see grants and procurement contracts to the private and third sectors be conditional on those receiving organisations opting in to this transparency mechanism as well. Whoever receives it, it's public money, and we should set high standards. Given the initial proposals included in the Conservative motion, I'd appreciate hearing the thoughts of Conservative members on expanding it in that manner. Because it is a timely suggestion, given that the Scottish Greens' suggestion of a review of chief executive pay was accepted by the Scottish Government earlier this year. I'd hope that all parties engage with that review and with wider public sector pay policy at budget time. One policy I'd like to put on the record now would be to bring college principals into the chief executive pay framework. They're the heads of large public bodies in Scotland, and some principals are, completely unjustifiably in my view, on salaries larger than that of the First Minister. Indeed, the growth in principal pay over the last 30 years has massively outstripped that of college teaching and support staff. If this newfound enthusiasm in some quarters for good governance could extend to greater scrutiny of the governance of our colleges, it would have far more positive outcomes for the public than the partisan opportunism motivating this afternoon's debate. Because if the Conservatives are interested in good party governance, they really need to look much, much closer to home. Since the start of Russia's invasion of Ukraine a year ago, the Tory party has accepted at least £243,000 from Russian associated donors, according to the Good Law Project. Much of that, £175,000, came from Lubov Chirukin. Her husband's a former deputy finance minister under Putin, and a former chairman of the state corporation VBRF, which is rightly subject to sanctions in the UK. If that name's familiar here, it's because the same Lubov Chernukin also paid £20,000 for a meal with Ruth Davidson. That meal didn't go ahead, but the cheque was certainly cashed. The Tory party is awash in dodgy Kremlin-linked cash, and it has been for years. So I suppose we should be grateful to them for giving us this opportunity to put it on the parliamentary record. There's a clear conflict of interest in political parties nominating their donors for awards and privileges, but it's particularly outrageous for donors to be nominated for lifetime appointments to Parliament via the House of Lords. But the Tories took this one step further, as the Minister for Parliamentary Business has already mentioned, when they appointed a party donor, Malcolm Offord, not just to the Lords, but to the government as a minister in the Scotland office. This is a man who's never been elected to any office, who's not accountable to voters, and who will have the power to influence the laws of the UK for the rest of his life. And why is he in that position? He donated £150,000 to the Tory party in the years leading up to his appointment. Even other Tory party members have described the support Mr. Offord's received from their party leadership as cronyism, talking about the endorsement he received ahead of candidate selection for the 2021 elections to this Parliament. One Tory said anonymously, so it might even be somebody who's in the room today, it seems all you need to get an endorsement is to have deep pockets. Pretty damning indictment from your own party members. There are, of course, only two parties in this Parliament who won't nominate to the House of Lords. That's the Scottish Greens and the SNP. And I challenge those in the opposition who are extolling the virtues of transparency and accountability in government to reconcile that with their party's role in maintaining the undemocratic outrage of the Lords and arcane mechanisms which allow the royal family, for example, to amend draft legislation in secret. Presiding officer, the Conservatives demand transparency and accountability from everyone but themselves. This debate isn't motivated by principled belief in good governance. It's pure opportunism. But it's spectacularly backfired with a party with so much baggage of its own that we've barely scratched the surface this afternoon. So I'll finish by asking Douglas Ross if he wouldn't mind bringing a similar motion back in future. There's so much more rot at the heart of the Tory party, which we could do with putting on the parliamentary record.
Thank you, Mr. Crewe. And I now call Keith Brown, who will be the last speaker before I ask the front benches to close the debate. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm delighted to take part in this debate and grateful for the opportunity to provide some balance for the benefit of Conservative colleagues. And here, Douglas Ross muttering away. Could I just say I welcome this motion in the same way as the Hibs fans at McDermott Park 2 weeks ago welcomed Douglas Ross, but I won't use the same language as was used by the Hibs fans. The motion talks about the governing party, but as the Tories never tired of saying, as Stuart McMillan said, but often tiresomely from the Tories, Scotland has two governments, and theirs is the governing party also. And yes, the Tories are transparent, Presiding Officer, so transparent that it's crystal clear to everyone that this motion is nothing more than an attempt to grab some headlines and to deflect from the failures of their own government at Westminster. So take, for example, last week, they didn't seem to think that debating the UK government's abhorrent anti-immigration bill was a good use of their time. So transparent was their discomfort, you could only see one or two of the backbenchers. The others were completely transparent. However, this week they're here aplenty for a debate about party political matters. So let's play their game and do a wee test of transparency here. I'm happy to give way to any Tory member who can and will tell the Chamber how many members they have in Scotland. Anyone? Anyone? Are you going to answer the question before I allow you to take the intervention? Are you going to? No, I'll not take the intervention. He's not going to answer the question. But let's play the game. So apparently,
members, please resume. As members know, it is up to each individual member whether or not they take an intervention. Keith Brown.
Yeah, sorry, I couldn't hear much of that exchange. I've obviously touched the raw nerve with the Conservatives. A simple question, really, but Douglas Ross has failed to answer it so many times. I'm struggling to hear myself speak, Presiding Officer. Is it possible to get some quiet as they've been given when they made their speeches?
I think there has been kind of quite a lot of sedentary chit-chat throughout the debate, and all speakers probably have had to put up with a bit of that, but I would invite members to please listen to Mr Brown. Thank you.
According to their chairman, Craig Hoy, who's here today, there is a number, but they don't disclose it. Demanding the SNP do something we've already done whilst refusing to do it themselves, that seems to be the Tory way. I would also be happy to give way to any Tory who can tell us, and let's make this as easy as possible, just to the nearest £1 billion. How much did the Truss Quartang economic experiment cost the people of Scotland? If he answers the question.
I think he's giving way, Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful, because I want to go back to the last time he said he would give way to any member. Well, sorry, we can't have two...
Members, I think Mr Brown said that he would give way to Douglas Ross.
Yes.
Am I wrong in that, Mr Brown?
Yeah.
Well, I am not in charge. Mr Brown, please resume your members.
I, as the Chair, am not in charge of answers given, as members know well. Could we please just clarify, is the member giving way to Mr Ross or not?
No.
No.
I'm also happy to give way to any Tory... I'm also happy to give way to any Tory who could actually tell us... I can't hear what's been said here. To give it away to any Tory who can tell us not just how many members they have, but whether they actually know how many members they have, because that seems to be a moot point as well. And how can we expect... can I say, like Russell Finlay, I only have 4 minutes, most of which have been wasted already, so I'm not giving way.
Members?
How about when can we expect the publication of the... When we can expect the publication of the Russia report? No answer there. The motion talks of transparency in government. Can I say, I've said three times I'm not giving away, Presiding Officer.
Mr Ross, I think Mr Brown is indicating he is not giving away. Thank you.
So the motion talks of transparency in government, and we have no transparency whatsoever.
Point of order, Jamie Halker-Johnson.
My apologies. I was just wondering if Keith Brown, the SNP's deputy leader, might like to clarify whether his questions are rhetorical or they're actually genuinely looking for point of orders.
Mr Halker-Johnson, that is a debating point and not a point of order for the chair. Brown.
As ever, not a point of order. It's also true we should really be by now expecting the fact that the Scotland's other government, the Conservative government, will be releasing the polling evidence it collected at taxpayers' expense on support for Scottish independence. And how about an arithmetical question? How much is HS2 costing compared to its original estimate of around £30 billion, now over £100 billion? Or what is the operational status?
Mr Ross, I think Mr Brown has indicated in the past he's not giving me. Mr Brown, and Mr Brown, I would say that your time is coming to a close fairly soon. Mr Brown.
How much is the £3.5 billion aircraft carrier, the Prince of Wales, now worth since it's been stripped for parts for its sister ship? Mm-hmm. Or how much of the EU structural funds that used to come to Scotland and other parts of the UK have been cut from Scotland? So let's have no more pious lectures from the Tories on transparency. After all, in 2021, the current Prime Minister's tenure as Chancellor of Exchequer, it was revealed that the Treasury refused to comply with more Freedom of Information requests than any other department in Whitehall. Wow. We've also repeatedly, on our side, called for a full public inquiry into the revelation that the UK government used funds for COVID contracts to conduct research
into constitutional
issues.
Mr Brown, you will need to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Brown. We will now move to closing speeches, and I call on Michael Mara to wind up on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm happy to support the amendment in Jackie Bailey's name on behalf of the Scottish Labour Party. The SNP's descent into chaos in recent months has certainly brought the dark underbelly of their party management into the light of day. But the culture of secrecy, spin and cover-up has been far-reaching, and as Jackie Bailey rightly pointed out, has stretched the gap between party and government. And that does require remedy, it requires scrutiny, and it does require the measures outlined in Labour's amendment today. I would say it's been a debate of rather dubious standard at point, because these are incredibly serious issues. But there has been, I'm afraid, no shortage of audacity from the Tory benches. Russell Finlay in particular, to cite Orwell. Well, I'm reminded, I enjoy talking to you. Your mind appeals to me. It resembles my own, except that you happen to be insane, George Orwell said. And when you hear Willie Rennie and Ross Greer recounting the VIP lane stuffed with Kremlin money, I think it's right that these points are made and riposte to where the Tory motion is coming from today. But the backbenches of the SNP have been rather remiss, it's fair to say as well, and the Minister in his opening, in the lack of recognition from the lack of transparency from this government over many years, the surprisingly thin paper trail on the decision of what to award ferry contracts to Ferguson Shipyard. Reports from Audit Scotland, almost too numerous to mention, calling on the Scottish Government to improve transparency, particularly with regard to how they spend taxpayers' money. A paucity of data on how nearly £5 billion of COVID-19 funding to support businesses was actually spent. And again, as my colleague Jackie Bailey highlighted, the SNP's government's dissembling their dishonest and duplicitous approach to the provision of documentation in the Salmond inquiry, with that committee facing obstruction at every turn. And so then we take the exploitation of lobbying register loopholes, meaning that in 2020 alone, hundreds of meetings between Scottish Government's ministers and lobbyists were not registered. And a fully contemptuous approach to freedom of information requests, not at this moment, thank you, a contemptuous approach to freedom of information requests, culminating most shamefully in their failure to disclose COVID-19 data and modelling. And that cover-up then challenged by the Scottish Information Commissioner, saying that the lack of compliance found there was a strong public interest in publishing that data. It's absolutely clear, Presiding Officer, that when we come to warnings about patient safety from staff and patients at Queen Elizabeth University Hospital that were covered up in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, they were aided and abetted by the then Health Secretary, Humza Yousaf. And he failed to remove those responsible, backing that culture of secrecy, cover-up and incompetence. And while to most that behaviour showed Mr Yousaf to be unworthy of his position, in the eyes of the SNP High Command, it proved he was the ideal candidate, the continuity candidate, capable of ascending to the highest office in the land. But the people of Scotland are not fooled in any of this. They are led by that continuity candidate, and it is infected by the same culture of secrecy, spin and cover-up that has festered at the heart of their party for too long. Again, as Orwell said, the end was contained in the beginning. So the amendment we have from Labour today puts in place serious measures, serious actions that can improve transparency on behalf of the people of Scotland. The good governance of our country and the public services on which we all rely need to see the restoration of integrity and transparency to the heart of government. And Scottish Labour's Stronger Holyrood paper sets out how we would do that and is contained in this amendment today. And I hope the Chamber is able to back it in that spirit.
Thank you, Mr Mara. I now call on Tom Arthur, Minister, to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 5 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking members for their contributions from across the Chamber this afternoon? I think it's very important as a Parliament that we consider how we can enhance scrutiny and transparency, both of the work of the Government more generally, also of the activities of Parliament, which have been touched on as well. And I think it's important to recognise that we do operate within a devolved context, so the way in which this Parliament and this Government interacts with the UK Government and the way in which processes are conducted by the UK Government and indeed the UK Parliament, how they impact upon the processes that we undertake. And that is something that is quite clear when it comes to the matter of public finances and budgeting, because of course we operate under a fiscal framework, which I think we would all recognise as one of the most complex set of arrangements between a state level and a sub-state level government to be found anywhere in the world. There was, if I recall correctly, an OECD report a few years ago which highlighted that very point. And this can create genuine challenges in being able to present information transparently and clearly. Indeed, it can present challenges for government as well, particularly when we consider, as some members who have served in the House of Commons will be aware, of the rather esoteric approach to finance that Westminster has through votes on confidence, main estimates and supplementary estimates, which can mean that we discover changes to our own budget quite late on in the financial year. Now, we do have a process, a well-established process, set out in the Scottish Parliament with regards to public finances through the annual budget statement, followed up by the three-stage Budget Act, and routinely two budget revision processes throughout the financial year. Indeed, during the COVID pandemic, we took the extraordinary step of an additional budget revision process. Along with that, we have statements on provisional outturn, we have a rates resolution as required under statute, and the local government finance order, providing multiple parliamentary opportunities for engagement, certainly.
Jackie Bailey.
I am grateful to the Minister for laying out the budget process, but I wonder whether I might ask him, in the interests of transparency, will he encourage the cessation of the use of SNP emails and WhatsApps to avoid scrutiny of ministerial discussions and decision-making?
Minister.
Everything that we undertake in government and all decisions that we take around the budget process are taken through the Scottish Government Scots system, and that information is there. And I can certainly assure members that that is a process that I and my colleagues undertake. What I would want to come back to, I've already given way, and I barely have a minute.
Ms. Bailey, are you making a point of order? Or?
Oh, I'm happy to make a point of
point of order.
No, I wasn't inviting you. I was just asking you.
I'm making a point of order, presiding
officer. Point of order, Jackie Bailey.
I wonder whether the Cabinet, the Minister indeed, heard my question, because he certainly hasn't answered it.
Ms Bailey, as you know, that is not a point of order. Minister, over to you.
Now, with regards to the processes as I was setting out, I also I made reference to the ongoing work around the budget process, but I recognise that there is a desire to do more, and I've certainly sought through engaging with the Finance and Public Administration Committee. And I would say a constructive engagement with Liz Smith and indeed with Daniel Johnson in his former role, and I look forward to constructive engagement with Mr Mara about ways in which we can provide additional information, particularly around these budget revision processes, which can be quite fluid and dynamic, and particularly with the challenges we face around supplementary estimates. And I'm very keen, yeah, certainly.
Willie Rennie?
With this calm and intelligent contribution, I don't think he's been in the earlier debate this afternoon. But nevertheless, would he be in favour of a freedom of information reform in the lines that Katie Clark is proposing, which will allow us to be able to scrutinise the public finances in public bodies?
Minister.
Well, I know that the government will be consulting on matters pertaining to FOI. As a minister, I do not have lead responsibility in FOI, but the member has made his points. The Minister for Parliamentary Business will have heard the points that the member has made. The point I would want to come to, is, presiding officer, is that in our consolidated accounts, we have had unqualified clean audits for the past 17 years. But I nonetheless recognise that there are always going to be challenges around ensuring that information is accessible and is as transparent as possible, because it is absolutely vital that the work that we undertake in this place is as accessible and transparent to the people who vote for us. Now, that would always be challenging with any state in terms of public finance.
I fear the Minister probably is bringing his remarks to close.
Regards to the devolved context in which we operate. But I make that open offer, as I have previously. I want to ensure that all of the people we are so privileged and honoured to serve have as much information as possible, and that that information is presented in a way that is transparent and inherently discernible and easy to grasp. So any members who do have a desire to, beyond the theatrics of today, to engage constructively on something which is of such vital importance, I very much want to have these discussions and conversation. I look forward to the conversation that's going to be having with opposition finance spokespeople, but I say I extend that offer to all members of Parliament, because it is something that we have a shared interest in and a shared responsibility to effect. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Murdo Fraser to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you, presiding officer. And can I thank all the participants in the debate this afternoon? And there are many issues we would rather have been debating this afternoon. Indeed, we'll shortly be moving to a debate on the vital subject of highly protected marine areas. But this debate was sadly necessary, because the whole issue of SNP party finances, the scandal, perhaps even criminality, has become a distraction from the business of this government. And that is why we called for the First Minister to come clean, to come to Parliament, to make a statement on his party finances, so we could all move on. But he, of course, has refused to do so, and he has sent George Adam to do his dirty work for him. Now, I will say this, at least for Mr Adam, he has a sense of humour. He read out the line in the amendment that good governance and transparency are matters of the utmost importance, with a straight face. I commend him for that. At this rate, he will be making a bid to fill the vacancy that has now appeared at the Stan Comedy Club by the removal of Joanna Cherry, who has been cancelled by the Stan Comedy Club. Perhaps Mr Adam will be there. And how sorry it is, incidentally, that nobody in her own party seemed prepared to speak up for Joanna Cherry. Not the Constitution Secretary, not Shirley-Ann Somerville on the radio this morning prepared to speak up for, not even the First Minister. It's left to people on this side of the chamber defending free speech and defending Joanna Cherry. And what we heard as well in this debate is there seemed to be only one line of defence from the SNP. There was only one thing they kept repeating parrot-like. How many members do you have? They kept saying, you think the entire army of spads and advisers and spin doctors and press officers could have dreamed up one other attack line other than simply how many members you have? Even poor Keith Brown was exhausted at the end of this debate, presiding officer. Now, presiding officer, there are legitimate questions here that need to be answered. And it's simply not enough to say that because there is a police inquiry, answers cannot be provided. What has happened to the 600,000 pounds of ring fence funds raised for another independence referendum. What is the real position with the SNP party finances? Are they, as some have suggested, on the brink of financial collapse? Why did the auditors resign? Why did the former chief executive grant a substantial personal loan, which has only now partly been repaid? And why on earth did they purchase a camper van as a campaign vehicle, one that doesn't seem to have moved for the last 2 years? None of this makes any sense. And we learned today, Presiding Officer, that the SNP have now appointed new auditors, AMS Accountants of Manchester. Not perhaps the greatest start to learn that that business has already been late in filing necessary paperwork at Companies House. I hope they attend to the SNP documents better than they handle their own. But what we see of the SNP finances is just all too typical of the way this government conducts its business, as a number of members around the chamber have made clear. Now, last week in the finance debate, I identified concerns raised about a lack of transparency across a whole range of government decisions, including investment in private funds, companies such as BIFAB, Prestwick Airport and GFG Alliance. And these are issues that have been identified by the former Auditor General, by the current Auditor General and even by this Parliament's Finance Committee. And we learned this week from evidence sessions at that same committee that former ministers, senior civil servants and special advisers have denounced Scottish Government decision-making as, and I quote, rushed, unclear and unstructured. Even those who have been at the heart of this government know they are getting this badly wrong. Now, Liz Smith reminded us earlier of the need for greater transparency in government. Yes, I'll give way.
Fraser MacGregor.
I'll give him way. Has him and his party got any self-awareness at all? I've been sitting listening to this debate, and this is the party here who took us all for mugs during the pandemic. Took us for mugs. Contracts for cronies. Is the Labour Party pointed out to you? Is the UK Labour Party pointed out to you? And you partied the whole time. I think this is absolutely shameful today.
Myrtle Fraser.
What a bizarre intervention, Presiding Officer. Nothing to do with the debate. But can I just say to the member, I think when we shine a light on the Scottish Government's track record on procurement of PPE and other matters, we'll find that the choices they made were not very dissimilar to the choices made from the UK Government at that particular time. So he needs to be very careful in terms of what he was saying. Now, like Jackie Bailey, I can well recall 2 years ago sitting on a committee of this Parliament looking at the handling of harassment complaints against the former First Minister, Alex Salmond, and the deplorable attempts at cover-up that we saw from this SNP Government. The refusal to release vital documentation that committee needed and the unwillingness to cooperate with a cross-party inquiry. And it took a threat of a vote of no confidence in John Swinney, the then Deputy First Minister, to get the documentation that that committee of this Parliament required. Nothing, it seems, has got any better in the interim period. So today, Presiding Officer, we have a motion noting this lack of transparency in the government and giving a range of positive proposals as to how to make matters better. It also calls for a statement to this Parliament on the governance of the Scottish National Party, the party of government in this place. And these are all matters of legitimate public interest. And we know there are those on the SNP benches in this Parliament who actually share our concerns. They agree with us that something has gone far wrong with SNP finances. They are as appalled as we are at what has been going on, and they, like us, want answers. Now, we've already seen within the SNP a willingness amongst some backbenchers to stand up to their leadership. We've seen that over issues such as the A9, over DRS. We might be about to see it in relation to marine protected areas. We saw it in relation to the GRR bill with an unprecedented rebellion. I would call on the SNP backbenchers today to show the same resilience. I'm not a supporter of independence, Presiding Officer. But if I was trying to make the case for independence, I would want to demonstrate that this Scottish Government was as effective and transparent as possible. Immense damage is being done to the body politic in Scotland from this culture of secrecy and cover-up. I hope all members from all parties will be prepared to join with us in voting for this motion today. And I hope, in particular, those with conscience and backbone on the SNP benches will be prepared to join us, because it is the least that Scotland will expect.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser.
And that concludes the debate on transparency of Scotland's governing party. And there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position, should they wish. Thank you.